Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Executive Director of the Nobel Peace Center, Kjersti Fløgstad.
Warmly welcome to this celebration of the Nobel Peace Prize laureates of 2022. And please have a seat. There's more seats in front here, so all of you standing in the behind, just come forward. You can go in the sides here. We are so much looking forward to learn more about this year's laureates and explore their important work. The exhibition that we are in right now is a celebration of last year's laureates. And this will be replaced with an exhibition about the new prize, the laureates, and the cause that they are fighting for. And that will happen in only 2 months. But it is interesting to see that many of the themes and what they are concerned about are the same. The coming year, we will be exploring the Nobel Peace Prize through exhibition, school programs, and events here at the Nobel Peace Center. This is the first event. Today, we are so happy and honored to have the chair of the Norwegian Nobel Committee, Berit Reiss-Andersen, with us. And she will give a deep dive into this year's laureates and maybe reveal some details about the way the committee has worked to choose a winner the winners this year. But first, something else shall happen here on the stage. Berit, would you like to come and join me, please? Thank you. I know you have had a very, very busy day yesterday. You made a huge amount of interviews, and so we're very happy to have you here on the stage. Thank you so much.
I'm delighted to be here. This is a tradition that I come to the Peace Center and give an introduction of the prize, but we are...
First, we are going to...
Reveal something new.
Yes, we are. The laureates, they will, when they come to Oslo in December, they will get three things. They will get the Nobel Peace Prize money. They will get, of course, a Nobel medal, Peace Medal, which you have a little replica of on your... It's a lovely piece made by the artist Gustav Wigeland.
But mine is not in pure gold, as the Nobel medal will be.
And it's going to be made now at Kongsberg in a few weeks. Yes, three of them. And they get a diploma. And the Nobel Peace Prize diploma for 2022, that is what we are now going to reveal first, isn't it? So will you help me doing that? Or perhaps you would like to tell us a little bit about the work of the committee with the diploma?
Yes. The tradition of inviting an artist to create a diploma started rather late in the Nobel history. We started in the 60s, and we select an artist to create a diploma, or several diplomas if there's several prize winners, as this year. And we have lately started to select an artist that we commission for a period of 3 years. And we are now in the middle of the three-year period of a very renowned and very highly regarded Norwegian artist called Håkon Bleken. He's really the grand old man of Norwegian paintings. And he makes examples for us, and the committee, we review these drafts as seriously as we review the possible laureates. And we make a selection, and it is made before the artist creates his work, before he knows who will be the Peace Prize laureate. And I think when we reveal these this year's three diplomas, you will see that his motives are definitely very much open to interpretation. Should we cut the suspense?
Yes, because it's almost as secret as the laureates, isn't it? So please. Whoops. This was the first.
Thank you. Something to do with humanity, perhaps.
Yes. And shall we do this one? We are posing.
It's the photo session.
Okay. Okay, Berit, then. Now we are really looking forward to hear your lecture, Berit. And so we all tune in, and Berit will be ready.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here. And I will just shortly repeat to you the three Peace Prize laureates that I had the pleasure of announcing yesterday. And when announcing the prize, we have a tradition that I open my speech by saying the Norwegian Nobel Committee has decided to award the Nobel Peace Prize to, and then comes a name, and all the journalists are standing on their toes. And this year, I tricked them because I did not announce their names. I said the Peace Prize is to one individual and two organizations. And then I explained the kind of efforts that the award was about, that they represent civil society in their countries, and that they have for many years promoted the right to criticize power and protect the fundamental rights for citizens. And why did I make this twist? Because I realized if I immediately started to announce the names of the two organizations and the individual, people would start to wonder, what is this about? How are they connected? So I wanted to introduce this understanding before anybody knew who I was talking about. But who was I talking about was, of course, Alice Bialatsky from Belarus, the Russian human rights organization Memorial, and the human rights organization Center for Civil Liberties in Ukraine. The issue that we wanted to address with this year's Peace Prize is the importance of civil society. In our minds, the importance is that in a functioning democracy, civil society plays a role in the power balance. division of power is a very important democratic principle. And you know that we divide it in state power division, but there is the freedom of speech that is extremely important, which is a human right, but it is even more so the totality of the activities that people perform as individuals or through organizations with no other mandate except that they believe in their cause, that they feel an urge to raise their voice, to perform their criticism, bring attention to this issue or that issue. And that is the importance of civil society. And that is where it is a counterforce to political power and political institutions. The idea about division of power is that everybody needs a different point of view. Everybody needs criticism, because criticism actually is essential in our way of thinking, of taking a different position, viewing problems from a different angle. And the importance of civil society is not reserved for authoritarian states. It is equally important in democracies. And the more civil society and their activities is accepted, I would claim, the stronger democracies. Now, this year's Peace Prize laureates, they all come from countries that are in a very difficult situation. Belarus is dictatorship. And Alice Bialatsky has spent literally his entire life, from he was a very young man and up until now, when he has turned 60 years old and unfortunately looks a lot older, because his life has, he has in his life gone through a lot of hardships. I mentioned yesterday that he has been imprisoned. He is in prison right this moment. I don't know if he has been informed about the Peace Prize. I know that if somebody nods there that he is informed, I have been informed that they sent a telegram to the prison yesterday, some of his friends, and but that they hadn't been, it hadn't been confirmed that the news had reached him. I'd be happy to speak to you later and hear details about that. His wife hasn't seen him since he was arrested in July last year. He is in isolation in a special block of the prison under appalling conditions. There was an interview today in a Norwegian newspaper where they a friend of him made a comment, Andrei Sannikov, and he says, I'm just translating it from Norwegian. The battle for freedom is not glamorous. It is a long and dangerous road to walk. The real heroes are those who follow this path without ever yielding the direction. Alice is such a hero. I think that was really spot on. Memorial is a human rights center that has its roots back in the Russian intelligentsia in the Soviet Union. And it started off documenting the atrocities that took place in Russia during the Stalin reign. And they have, from that beginning, continued to document state atrocities within Russia and Russian-run wars and conflicts. And the idea is, in fact, the same idea that is behind the International Criminal Court, that by documenting atrocities, holding people accountable, is a way to prevent new wars, new atrocities. It's a similar focus in Center for Civil Liberties, Originally, they were a human rights organization with a special focus on principles of rule of law, advocating measures to strengthen the Ukrainian democracy. Ukraine was not a very well-developed democracy prior to the invasion. But now they have shifted their focus in exactly documenting war crimes against civilians in Ukraine. And what connects these two organizations and Bialatsky together? They represent ordinary people who follow their conscience and work for what they believe in. And that is a very important message to all of us, because anybody can take that platform. They work for the same values, the same goals, democracy, human rights, rule of law, anti-militarism. And they work for these goals, disregarding the borders and the different regimes in their home countries. So we would like to show a unity between civil society that is separated from the political regimes they are operating under. And this is also between neighbor states. So the term in Alfred Nobel's will, we can honor people who work for fraternity between nations, is truly spot on when it comes to this year's Peace Prize. Yesterday was a day, of course, very moving. It always is very touching to announce the prize, contact the laureates, and even more, listen to the comments. Of course, there were very critical comments from Belarus and from Russia, from the more apparatchnik representatives. I was surprised by one comment, and I hope it's not very authoritative, from Ukraine that said, how can the Nobel Committee award a prize to people representing those who attacked us? And this is exactly the point. Civil society represents themselves as individuals, as people, as their organizations. They are not representatives of the state. They are something separate. And also the commentator said, it is Zelensky who should have had the prize because the road to peace is war. This is a statement. It's not the first time that kind of statement has been made, and I'm not going to discuss the meaning of the statement itself, but the terms of Alfred Nobel's will is very clear that we can never grant a peace prize to a person or an organization because they are running a war. Even if it is a just war where you are defending yourself and you are have the right to do so according to international law, and you have been attacked by an aggressor, as is the case. That's just outside of our scope. But the Peace Prize has often been awarded to people who, in fact, have participated and been responsible for wars. But when they have received the Peace Prize, it is for their efforts. The most famous one was the Oslo deal and the Middle East Prize to Menachem Begin and Arafat, and I'm sorry, I got the blank point in my head. also, when Nelson Mandela got his prize, William de Klerk shared it with him. He was definitely a representative of the perpetrator, of the aggressor. But the award was for changing a position and taking a stand to create peace. And that is something profoundly different than being active in warfare. Okay, I think I should close now. We don't have very much time. But I would like to say that in a few months, we will receive representatives of the three laureates. Now, of course, I still have a hope that we maybe will be able to receive Alice Bialatsky. And I think we have really disturbed the Belarusian authorities, because to have the world's attention upon you because you are keeping a Nobel Peace Prize laureate in prison, and even in prison without having been convicted for a crime or had a trial, is an embarrassment. To release him and let him travel to Norway and speak may also be an embarrassment. So the best thing we have achieved is perhaps creating the dilemma. Memorial is in fact shut down recently, which is very sad because they have been operating for a long time in Russia. They have never been very high regarded by authorities, but I think it is very symptomatic that they were shut down months before the Russian invasion in Ukraine. I think there's a connection. And I was asked so many times yesterday, I will close, but I would just say this. Is this a prize against Putin? No, it is not a prize against Putin. It is a prize for civil society. But Putin and any other authoritarian state leaders are drawing attention to themselves when they make state enemies out of people who are simply speaking their minds and advocating human rights, democracy, and rule of law. And that is what it is all about. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Berit. It's always so interesting to listen to you. We learn always new things. Last year, you learned, taught us the importance of journalists for democracy. And now you have been talking about each and one of us, civil society, as important fighters for democracy. So thank you so much. No, you don't have to stay. Oh, you have to stay.
I'm staying. Yeah.
Because now we have a surprise for all of you. We have been able to get hold of the new laureates. And they will be with us here on screen just now. Of course, Alice Bialatsky, he will not be able to attend on link, because as Berit said, we don't even know whether he knows he's got the prize and he's in prison. But we have representatives for the two other laureates with us, and they will be with us on screen as hello. Hi. It's lovely Hello. To see you. Hello. Hi. Tatiana Gushkova from Memorial Human Rights Organization. Hello.
Hello.
Hi. Hello. Warmly welcome. And Alexandra Romantsova from the Center of Civil Liberties. Hello and warmly welcome to you as well.
How
congratulations. How was yesterday, Tatiana? Would you like to start?
Yes. Well, I would say that yesterday was kind of a blur to us. We didn't expect it at all. We all were in shock when we think that we got numerous congratulations from different sources. While our colleagues in Moscow were waiting in a courtroom to learn whether the authorities have the right to confiscate our office in Moscow. And further during the day, things got back to business as usual because our office got confiscated. And we think that it can be viewed as the Kremlin's response to the fact that Memorial was one of the Nobel Prize winners.
So,
Tatiana, this is Berit Reiss-Andersen speaking. I'm the chair of the committee. I have a question for you. Do you believe in a fair trial concerning the issue of whether you remain closed down, or do you believe that it is politically rigged so the outcome is already evident?
The judgment on the liquidation of Memorial of two memorial organizations has already become final earlier this year. And we do not believe it was any kind of a fair trial. And the outcome of the trial was absolutely predictable for us. We do not unfortunately, we do not think that the Nobel Peace Prize award will somehow change this outcome, because as we know that, for example, the Nobel Peace Prize did not protect Alexander Solzhenitsyn from being expelled from the Soviet Union. It did not protect Andrei Sakharov from being sent to exile to the city of Gorky. It did not protect Nova Gazeta, whose editor-in-chief was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize last year, from It did not protect Nova Gazeta from being closed this year, so we do not think that it will somehow change things for us.
Thank you. And I have another question. Is there any chance that even though you are liquidated, that you will manage to save and secure the very important archives of Memorial?
Yes, of course. We hope that we will manage to, we already have conducted a lot of work in order to protect our archives, and we hope that we'll be safe and we will be able to continue our mission and to work with the archives and to even fill them with new items. By the way, that yesterday, the day when we were awarded the Nobel Peace Prize and our office in Moscow was confiscated, two exhibitions were opened, two exhibitions based on Memorial archives were opened, one in Tbilisi, Georgia, and one in Syktyvkar, Russia. So we still hope to be able to continue our work and promote our mission.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's easy to understand. It feels like a mixed blessing today with all the attention also. Alexandra Romantsova, hi to you and congratulations also.
Hi.
How was your day yesterday?
Thank you. Oh, that was really hard day because we just wasn't in trip. We back from Warsaw from Warsaw Human Dimension Conference. So all journalists trying to catch us, and we was in train. That was really hard with connection. But for us, it sure started to be a huge surprise because sure, whole the Ukrainian population now is fighting, and our work, it's like started not only in 2014 when war started. We started work before, but we just not expected. That was really a big surprise. But we're really honored, and we're really happy that our colleagues from Memorial and from Vesna, Alice Bletsky, founder of Vesna, same together with us, because as for us, it's exactly people who do all what they can, like prevent war which happened with Ukraine and each before war campaign from Russian Federation, like Chechnya, Syria, Moldova, Georgia, all other. So we really honored to be together with them and have this prize.
That's so good to hear.
Thank you. Could you tell us about the reactions to you winning a share of the Peace Prize, the reactions in Ukraine, among people, official comments? Could you give us a flavor of that, please?
We have a few different reactions, sure. Official not react any, exactly. That was small surprise for us because usually every day we have video with president and he don't say nothing. So we think that it's complicated situation in media area here in Ukraine, because any Russians, representative Russian population, it's now the people which Ukraine have questions exactly what happened inside your country that Putin can speak from your population and can speak by guns. So that was a lot of people don't have any idea exactly about what exactly work Memorial and how work Alice Beletsky together with Vyasna. So they don't have this knowledge. So some of them even started to speak about that. They don't know exactly our organization, but it's really impossible here in Ukraine. If they know don't know our organization, they surely know some of our projects and campaign which we're doing, like Evromedad Source or Safe Election Salt, because that was no whole the world. And so it's big question here. As for me, because they don't have become enough information from one side, from other side, because they there is not exist like simple answers. What kind of responsibility each representative of Russian population in this war, but exactly these people from Memorial and from Vyasna, I'm surely know what they do in last 8 years. So we prepared to speak about that. Like half of our we'll have our first press conference here for Ukrainian and international media which come in here in Kyiv, which work in Kyiv. So we will try and explain, because for us it's really important that Ukrainians believe in human rights defenders everywhere and feel that human rights like standards need to be for democracy in Ukraine when we're in war and when we will win.
And that's often a consequence of an effect of the Nobel Peace Prize and being a laureate, that people will be very much interested in listening to your cause and what you're doing. So perhaps the role of civil society and your work in Ukraine and Russia and Belarus, where you have the same values and same as civil society organizations, you have the same values and same goals, will be more clear to people perhaps.
We'll try explain, but it's not only about like even values, if about even strategical decision, what kind of society we want. And healthy society for our mind, it's a society which remember that human dignity and human rights, it for all the people. And if the people fighting for that in their society, even it's a more complicated environment than here in Ukraine, because here we have a war, sure, but we have a support, all the population, all the people want to be in democracy structure and prepared to fight for that. But inside the Belarus and inside the Russia, it's more complicated because not many people, as for me, not like I want, like support human rights defender organization and other people who are trying to bring democracy values. So we really want to communicate about that. It will not easy for us, seriously. But we know that Ukrainians more likely understood that, I hope.
But that is one of the reasons your organization received the Peace Prize, is your efforts also to educate your own people. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you so much. We have some greetings to you from last year's laureates. Let us hear what Dmitry Muratov has said. Or let's see what he has said. He says, he sent his greetings. A peace prize for those who fight despotism in their own countries and other. The prize will go to the battlefields in Ukraine, to Belarusian prisons, and to Stalin's gulag. I congratulate and I'm proud of the Ukrainian Center for Civil Liberties, Lukashenko's prisoners, Alice Bialetsky and his Vizna, the Russian Indomitable Memorial. So that was from Dmitry Muratov. And then let's hear what Maria Ressa sent us over the phone.
The Norwegian Nobel Committee last year was prescient in its choices of journalists under attack, and within 4 months you had Russia invade Ukraine. This year's choices of recognizing civil society, activist groups on the front lines, recognizes that further takes forward the recognition that democracy is in grave danger and calls on the forces that are necessary to protect it, the journalists, civil society, activists for democracy. Also, it's very clear what you're seeing, which is just Russia's aggressive moves around the world. Anyway, congratulations to the winners.
Again, Tatiana and Alexandra, thank you so much. Congratulations. And we look forward to seeing you hopefully in Oslo here in December. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And again, thank you to Berit. And now we will, as you see, we are setting the stage for a panel discussion about the theme of this year's prize. The panel will be moderated by my good colleague Ingvild Bryn Ramberg. Give her a warm applause. And you will introduce the panel. And
I'll thank you, Kjersti. And you are among the panel. So I invite you to take a seat over here together with Henrik Urdal, director of PRIO, Peace Research Institute of Oslo. And together with them, Inna Sangadzhieva. She is director for Europe and Central Asia in the Norwegian Helsinki Committee. And there you are, Ina. Welcome. Okay, we've heard now the voices of two representatives of two of the laureates that were awarded yesterday. But we are missing one. So I want to start with you, Inna. You are a personal friend of Alice Bialetsky. You've met him several times. If he had been able to join us today, what do you think he would have said?
First, I want to say that Alice Bialetsky knows that he received the prize. I just got a message from a group, just double checked whether he knows. He knows.
Oh, that's so good to hear. Yes. Thank you.
You know, Alice is one of the most wonderful persons I know. I met him back 2006 when the Norwegian Helsinki Committee gave him our Andrei Sakharov Prize. And he, I think if he were here, he would be thrilled. He will smile, as he always does from ear to ear. And but he will also give the message as well to the people he works together with and to the Belarusian society that this prize is also sharing with all the people in Belarus. Remember that in 2020, in August, thousands of people went to the streets and they showed that they want to have a change. And Alice Belatsky and his team has been one of those who has been for many, many years working on establishing the rule of law and institutions in Belarus and prevailing of human rights.
Thank you. Thank you so much for telling us that he has actually received the news, because that was new to us and I think probably new to the committee as well. And Berit Reiss-Andersen, she exclaimed a hope yesterday about his coming to Oslo in December. How probable do you think that is?
Unfortunately, as Václav Havel said 10 years ago, among the countries who has experienced the communist regimes, the transformation of the society will happen at the worst price in Russia, and I would also add Belarus, because Belarus and Russia now are the countries who are running almost from the same kind of source of power, which is also quite violent, and that means that unfortunately the you know, the civil society groups, they only have the rule of law and common values as weapons, while the opposite side, the regime, has weapons and threats and propaganda. It's a quite an equal measurable. So I will really hope that he will be released. That's really my hope. But of course, we cannot, as it's now, expect that it will be reality.
Do you think the prize might have a positive effect on his situation? Just short on that.
I think that the prize has a tremendous signal for the whole society. That's very important. And in any changes, in regime changes, the society are those who should protect the values, and this is, I think, the process Alice and his team has been always aware of. So yes, I want to hope that this will help him. Yes.
Thank you. All the three laureates, they represent civil society in their countries, and they all work with documenting human rights abuse and war crimes. And Henrik Urdal, what do we know about how civil society actually is work for peace?
Well, first, if you may allow me, I would like to congratulate the three winners, and also as representing a research institution and a researcher who's been trained to be, you know, critical. It's difficult to be critical of the committee these days, because I think it was it's not only a good prize, but it's also a very well motivated prize. From our perspective, this was exceptionally welcome. Then we know that if you look sort of across countries over time, that respect for fundamental human rights, respect for political rights, democratic features of governance are associated with stability and with peace and with quality of life. So I think the committee has probably read up on a lot of political science literature, and there's a lot of competence in the committee. But I think it's again it's well motivated. And Berit Reiss-Andersen said that she tricked the journalists by not announcing the names immediately. My reading, and she also tricked several of us. We were waiting for the names, but I think that introduction also spoke to the much broader issue, which we should of course focus on. The I think it was appropriate that it was a prize that also spoke to the current situation in Ukraine and in Russia and Belarus. But it's also a prize that speaks much broader to all of those human rights defenders, all of those civil society organizations that work in autocratic societies and make a huge contribution and a huge difference. And so I think this is a prize that also resonates much broader than the context of Ukraine and Belarus and Russia.
Mm-hmm. So it's a very current, very topical prize, but Kjersti Fløgstad, director of the Nobel Peace Center, it's also a prize that resonates with the legacy of Alfred Nobel and the history of the Nobel Peace Prize. Can you say something about how this prize fits into the history, the long history of the Nobel Peace Prize?
As also Berit mentioned, it's very well founded on the will of Alfred Nobel, the fraternity between people. Civil society is a very good kind of demonstration of just that. And so it's very well founded in his will. And then it has a long history also, civil society organizations and fights within the Nobel Peace Prize history. From the 60s, there were several prizes going forward on this issue. So it's I think it fits also in a long history. And then also, as we sit here in last year's exhibition or prize, it also has kind of a continuation from last year, as we see it. We got to know Maria Ressa and Dmitry Muratov's work very well during the year that we have been. And we can see kind of journalists, even if they have a specific role as critical voices, they are also part of nurturing civil society. So the interlink between people and the critical voices is kind of taken even further in this year's prize, I see. And Maria Ressa has been very concerned about the development of democracy. Research shows that 70% of the world's population today lives in autocracies or dictatorship countries. And she is afraid, and many of us are afraid, that this is going the wrong way. So to kind of fight for that, and help kind of democracies thrive further, civil society will be very important going forward. So I think the Nobel Peace Prize this year is shining a light on a very, very, very important issue in our time. Mm.
Henrik Urdal, can you say something about what kind of signal this prize is sending out to especially autocracies in the world and the civil society role there?
So the committee was, and Berit Reiss-Andersen yesterday was clear on the prize not being against anyone, but of course it is a prize to those who work against the agendas of the autocrats, and I think this is a message that is being clearly received. I don't think it is going to change anything overnight, but it is a very strong signal to be sent. And then I think there is another dimension of the prize yesterday that perhaps did not get as much attention as it should, and that's the other sort of pillar of the rationale for the prize, and that's the documentation and the systematic collection of data of human rights abuses, of atrocities, which can also feed directly into both reconciliation processes, but also to legal processes, for instance, under the auspices of the International Criminal Court, the ICC, which is already in Ukraine collecting evidence. So I think this is an important part, mm-hmm. and again, you know, a continuum also from the prize last year with the importance of documenting, of making available the evidence that that comes out of this important work.
Yeah, not only documenting, but also making it more difficult for leaders to rewrite history
exactly.
by hiding all those evidence, mm. Which we have seen examples of in the countries of last year's laureates as well. Would you like to say something about that, Ina?
What I'm thinking about is that this prize is also an important symbol for in the processes which these countries are going through. And it's also concerning the whole post-Soviet era. It's empireful and search for identity and building a new common values and new understanding of what will be our common issues. And if back to empire and what actually both Putin and Lukashenko want, to bring back to the wars and empire common realities. But I think we are now, and again, this prize is also a very important symbol for the new era, that these people are that people which have not been seen during the Soviet regime, I mean Soviet time and the empire, now it's their time. And people come with demands for protecting human rights, building institutions, documenting demanding the authorities to follow human rights. That's a very important signal. And human rights can be this common platform for us to unite. And that's also been said both by Ukrainian colleagues and from Tatiana Glushkova, was that it's also a matter of Nobel, you know, and Andrei Sakharov. It's about progress, peace, and human rights. And this is, I think, can be. And I'm not saying it can be. It will be like that. So we just have to move this direction.
How do you think the prize can affect memorials work?
I spent a lot of time reading reactions from Russia and Ukraine and Belarus and other places. And 99% is just overwhelming. And of course, reactions are different. But if I will say one thing, is that now we got a hope. And you know, when everything is dark and when you understand that you fight and fight and fight, it's getting worse and worse and worse. You don't think, oh, now I just can't bear it anymore. And suddenly you get the hope. So I think this were a lot of people suddenly started to discuss it again. And it's like new muscles to bring together.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Is it also more difficult now to close down the offices and hide all the documentation and store it away?
Yeah, but memorial is not, it's not organization per se. Oh. The memorial is a community of society. Mm. It is very, you know, it's because they have been like vaccinated, like got this vaccine of the territorial understanding. They know that all organization can be taking. That's why people get networks, horizontal networks, and they don't build like organization as we understand it here. They build communities. And memorial is about memory. It's about ancient history. It's about understanding past and go to the future. And these are people who are, you know, memorial have maybe 60 to 70 communities, and these networks will not disappear. Mm-hmm. I mean, you cannot just erase, I mean, what people decided in Kremlin, but doesn't mean that it will happen. So these people, and I myself from Russia, I remember this time, you know, you cannot just, you know, this memory is inside your family. It's a part of your story, and you cannot just kill all of us. So then you have to be really have been quite strong, and Putin is not strong now.
And you cannot give the Nobel Peace Prize to all of the human rights defenders, but you can probably give hope to many of them by giving a prize like this. You think so?
Yeah, but you know, the many comments I read yesterday was about this is our prize. Mm. It's a prize of civil society who has been for years fighting. You know, remember that we have one war which is very visual in Ukraine. We have one war which is not visual in against autocracies, people who, they are also soldiers, they also fight. And remember that they fight also real KGB officers, real soldiers, real people with weapon, with electroshock and others. This also should be, you know, kept in mind. This is also another war. And in addition, we have informational war, we have oil and gas wars, and so on. So these, the civil society now understand that they have, you know, they got the prize because they also know that it's not hopeless.
I think it's very interesting what you're saying about the organization of the resistance, and maybe you, Henrik, can say something about what research on civil society's effect on peace. Have you got any practical examples, any examples of situations where civil society have been able to create change?
Oh, a lot, and there is quite a bit of evidence that non-violent organizations are even more successful, of course, in extremely repressive regimes. The ability to operate may be severely limited, but there is quite a bit of evidence. Erika Chenoweth, who's a Harvard-based researcher, has done extensive research on non-governmental organizations and the way that they work and non-violently and the effect that this has. So it is a myth that armed violence is a more necessarily more efficient way of bringing about change. Then I think it is important that these organizations are also appreciating and acknowledging the way that these are bottom-up processes. And I think it was very good to see the reaction now from the Center for Civil Liberties, that they are embracing also the other winners, because I think that was one of the few disappointments yesterday, that there wasn't a clear message coming through from Ukraine that they're supporting these, you know, bottom-up, people-to-people contributions. And I hope that this is indicative of a change on the Ukrainian scene, and especially the official one, because these are all organizations that work to strengthen civil society, civil liberties within their countries, and they should be standing together rather than fighting.
And now we will have a full year where the role of civil society, where the fight of these brave human rights defenders will have the world's focus. Kjersti, can you say, what was your hope for this year?
Well, first and foremost, I hope we will have peace in the region. Not because of this prize, of course, but I mean, this is something we all hope for, that the war on Ukraine will have an end very soon. From our perspective, we will explore and celebrate the prize. So my hope is that we will be able to shine a light on the different organizations' work, the importance of civil societies, and also on perhaps strengthening movements. So what is going to happen now from our side is, first and foremost, we're going to open this new exhibition, as I said, but we will have Nobel Peace Talks about the issues that we have been discussing here. And then in September, we hope to be able to have the laureates coming back and to our big international peace conference on this issue. Mm. But by that time, I hope we can really get some support for what they are striving for. So that's what we hope, that we can help this prize further.
And I want to give the last word to you, Ina. What is your hope for this year? Very short.
I also hope for peace as soon as possible, and I also hope to see our friends free and here.
We share that hope. Thank you all for joining this session. It will not be the last time we discuss this theme, as Kjersti said. Give them a big hand. But before we end, okay, I want to thank you all for coming today to celebrate this year's Nobel Peace Prize, and I wish you welcome back to the Nobel Peace Center.